leukotriene modifiers or leukotriene antagonists. Oral leukotriene antagonists are anti-inflammatory in nature. They are not as effective as inhaled steroids to control the inflammation. Nonetheless, they could be add-on drugs for the anti-inflammatory action. Sometimes in very young children, this could be the first line treatment until 5 years. There are two drugs available, leukotriene modifiers, montelukast and gefurulukast. Of course, we have only montelukast in our country. Gefurulukast is not available. Montelukast is available as 4 milligrams, 5 milligrams and 8 milligram tablets. 4 milligrams for very young children, 5 milligrams for relatively grown up children and 8 milligrams for adults, to be used once a day. These could be add on drugs to inhaled corticosteroids and inhaled bronchodilators. Now let's say we have started a patient on inhaled corticosteroids and he is not getting the response. Attacks are not being prevented. He is getting recurrent episodes of bronchospasm. What could be the reason? Check the inhaler technique. Check whether the patient is regularly using the prescribed inhaled corticosteroids. If that is the case, then increase the dose of the inhaled steroid. Suppose he is taking 400 micrograms, make it 800. He is taking 200, make it 400. Even then, if the symptoms are not controlled, add a long-acting bronchodilator, long-acting beta agonist like formoterol or salmeterol. And in spite of that addition of LABA and double dose of inhaled steroids, the symptoms are not controlled, add a leukotriene modifier like montelukast. And of course, lastly, theophylline can be an add-on drug if the symptoms are still persisting. This is called the step-up and step-down treatment for acute asthma. For an acute asthma, the first step would be short-acting bronchodilator, short-acting beta agonist SABA in full dose, like salbutamol or terbutaline or levosalbutamol. Short-acting bronchodilator, the symptoms are not controlled, increase the frequency of short-acting bronchodilator or use an nebulization. In spite of that, if the acute asthma is not controlled, SABA is above plus inhaled bronchodilator epitropium add as an add-on drug. If still not controlled, oral corticosteroid methylprednisolone 30 to 60 milligrams for 3 to 10 days. And of course, if it is still not controlled, add inhaled corticosteroid 1000 micrograms per day and maintain for 6 weeks of minimum. Gradually bring down the dose of inhaled corticosteroid and oral corticosteroids and the IBDs. If the symptoms are not relieved, check the technique for compliance. With all these things, the patient is not responding, or the patient is not using the medication properly, and they are not using the correct technique. And also look for aggravating factors like gastroesophageal reflux, emotional overlay and stress, upper respiratory infections like sinusitis, allergic rhinitis. This could be the cause. Role of theophylline is questionable. Oral short-acting bronchodilators and long-acting bronchodilators, oral medications like syrups and tablets are not very useful in acute asthma. The step care approach for control of asthma. The previous slide we have seen for acute asthma. Now we are discussing about the prevention and controlling the asthmatic attacks. The first drug would be, there it is, short-acting bronchodilators. Here it is, inhaled corticosteroids. If not controlled with inhaled corticosteroids, add a long-acting bronchodilator like formoterol or salmeterol. ICS plus LABA, not controlled, increase the dose of ICS, double the dose of ICS. and still not controlled, ICS double dose, LABA plus leukotriene modifier, montelukast. Still not controlled, ICS double dose, LABA, leukotriene modifier plus oral corticosteroids. Still not controlled, add the other bronchodilator, the antimuscarinic agent, the tiotropium. Sustained release theophylline may be an add-on drug at that stage after the 5 or 6 steps. SABA or LABA oral ipratropium bromide may be useful add-on drugs to control the asthma. No long-acting steroid injections like Canacort and things like that. No injectable or short-acting theophylline at all. So the treatment of bronchial asthma mainly depends upon identifying what is the level of control. Depending on that, the therapeutic action will be tailored. So if the asthma is very well controlled, maintain and find the lowest controlling step. The asthma is partially controlled, consider stepping up to gain control. The asthma is uncontrolled, step up until it is controlled. There are exacerbations, treat exacerbations. So once you treat the exacerbation and the uncontrolled asthma is slowly being controlled, try to reduce the dose towards reduction. The asthma from being controlled moves to uncontrolled, try to increase the dose. So the treatment plan is, depending on what step the patient is, step 1, very well controlled asthma, step 2, mild asthma, step 3, moderate, step 4, severe asthma, very severe asthma. Depending on that, you reduce the treatment towards this side and you increase the intensity of the treatment towards the other side. The treatment options are, whatever may be the step of the asthma, controller options like as and when needed rapid acting beta 2 agonist, salbutamol, terbutaline, levosalbutamol on SOS basis can be given for step 1. For step 2, select low dose ICS or a leukotriene modifier in young children. In step 3, low dose ICS plus LABA, long acting bronchodilator, beta 2 agonist like your salmeterol or formeterol, or medium or high dose of inhaled corticosteroids can be used, or low dose inhaled corticosteroids plus leukotriene or low dose ICS plus sustained release theophylline. Any one of these would be the treatment of choice, but better would be ICS plus long acting beta 2 agonist. And as and when needed, use rapid acting SABAs. And then if it is step 4, add one or more of these medications in addition to what he is already getting in step 3. These could be medium or high dose of ICS plus long acting beta 2 agonist, leukotriene modifier, sustained release theophylline. And of course, if the patient is very severe uncontrolled asthma, oral corticosteroids in the lowest dose and maintained for few weeks, then slowly brought down. Anti-immunoglobulin E treatment with omalizumab could be a choice, and then PDE4 inhibitors can also be a choice. Why majority of the doctors do not use inhalation treatment? Status quo, I am happy with what I am practicing. I am no more to learn, no more to unlearn the old practices and start the new practices. My practice is good and great. Why should I change my behavior? Oral therapy is easy to prescribe and easy for the patient to. Patient's acceptance also is good. I'm too busy. I can't explain the inhalers and all. I have difficulty in convincing the patient because I myself not convinced. Cost. This will be costly inhalers. I have to buy an inhaler. MDI means around 200 rupees. Rotacaps means around 50-60 rupees. Patient may not be able to spend that much. In fact, in the long run, the inhaled treatment is much economical. A headache to explain, you know, the patients were to explain, the relatives, their grandmother, of everyone, their friends. So it's very difficult sometimes. So some of the doctors are reluctant to use inhalation treatment. What are the different drug delivery options we have? We can use the inhaled medications as MDI, metered-dose inhalers. Now we have got what are called autohalers. We'll see the demo. Dry powder inhalers, rotahalers, dry powder compressed tablets for disc. They're called disc halers, spaces and holding chambers, and of course the nebulizers. Most important step would be to demonstrate the correct technique of use of the inhaler and ask the patient to demonstrate back to you how he or she would use the inhaler. Which are the drug delivery options I choose? Should I choose a MDI? Should I choose the disc haler? Should I choose spacers, or what? Depending on the dexterity of the patient, how good is his coordination, the hand grip strength, and then the severity of the ROAD, the educational level of the patient, of course the age of the patient, and the ability to inhale and synchronize the MDI. So, pressurized metered-dose inhalers, rotahalers, discalers, spacehalers, gyrostats, nebulizers, mixed oxygen delivery. Of course, oral tablets and syrup should be discouraged. Parenteral IM and IV use should be avoided. All of us know this is the rotahaler or the dry powder inhaler, the MDI metered-dose inhaler, the spacers. Among the spacers, there are two types. There is a large volume spacer. There is also what is called the gyrostat or small volume spacer, which we will see in the next slide. So, this is an inhalation system, MDI. This is a combination inhalation inhaler. This is the small volume spacer and the aero chamber for very young children. For very young children, MDI plus large volume spacer is the ideal choice with a good fitting face mask. It's very convenient for the mothers to administer the drug. Child takes the tidal breath at his own normal speed, and there is a valve, and then the chamber holds the inhaled medicine, which will be taken in by the young infant. What drug delivery option I use? The very young and very old, metered-dose inhaler plus large volume spacer. The elderly, metered-dose inhaler plus small volume spacer. Young children more than 7 years, they will be liking the rotahalers, they can play with that, the DPI. Adults who are educated, they can use an MDI alone without a spacer. Adults with no coordination, again, DPI and rotahaler. Rotahaler is very convenient. They can put it in the pocket and take it for the work spot. The clinic setting, MDI with the spacer, and a clinic emergency, of course, nebulizer. The choice is to be individualized by trial and error method, and cost may be a factor. Rotahalers are very handy. Overcome the hand-lung coordination problem encountered with the MDIs. Can be easily used by children already and arthritic patients. Can take multiple inhalations if the entire drug cannot be inhaled in one inhalation. That's an advantage for many of the older patients and young children too. Gyrostat, non-static spacer made up of polyimide material, increased respirable fraction, increased deposition of the drug in the airways, increased aerosol half-life, plenty of time for the patient to inhale after the actuation of the drug. No valve is there, no dead space problem, less wastage of the drug, small, portable, easy to carry, and child friendly. Disc haler, the medicine is compressed into tablet form, and then once you activate the disc haler and puncture the tablet, the powder comes and the patient can inhale. Or the other option is the nebulizer, using a nebulizer medicine apparatus here. The medicine is nebulized using either a mouthpiece or a mask. When do I use nebulizer therapy? When severe breathlessness despite using inhalers, assessment should be done for improvement. Choice between a face mask and a mouthpiece. Face mask fits snugly. Mouthpiece, some patients prefer to have the mouthpiece and inhale through the mouth. Equipment, servicing and support are essential. The dose are 0.5 ml of ipratropium bromide, 0.5 ml of salbutamol and 5 ml of NaCl. Of course, not distilled water, please. If decided to use inhaled corticosteroids, add 0.5 ml of budesonide. That means if the FEV1 is less than 50%. 15 minutes is the inhalation time, slow to moderate flow rate, which will be comfortable for the patient. Can be repeated 2 to 3 times a day. You remember to always ask the patient to gargle and wash the mouth so that there is no secondary fungal infections of the throat, particularly the superimposed candidiasis. Patient education is an essential step in the control of asthma and the management of asthma. Explain the nature of the disease. It is inflammation. It's a chronic inflammation. Perpetual inflammation. Explain the action of the prescribed drugs. Stress the need for regular long-term therapy. That way only we can convince the patient. Allay fears and concerns related to inhaler use. Peak flow testing encourages the patient to continue with the medicine. Symptoms and treatment diary by the patient will help a long way in deciding whether the patient is progressing or whether it is compliance with the drug, whether it is using any difficulties. All these aspects can be looked into by looking at the symptom and treatment diary. What do I say to the patient? Patient education is the cornerstone of asthma management, long-term management. Asthma is a common disorder. It can happen to anybody and may not be lifelong. It is not caused by supernatural forces. Asthma is not contagious. All kin need not be affected. Recurrent attacks of cough with or without wheeze could be asthma. Between attacks, people with asthma lead normal lives. In most cases, there is some family history of allergy either in the patient himself or in the family. We need to tell the patient that it can be effectively controlled, although it cannot be cured. Effective asthma management programs include patient education, objective measurement of lung function using peak flow meter and spirometry, environmental control to reduce the exposure to the allergens, and of course the pharmacological therapy, particularly the inhalation therapy. A stepwise approach to pharmacological therapy is recommended. The aim is to accomplish the goals of therapy with the least possible medications and least possible side effects.